Good morning, everybody. My name is John Anderton, and I will be your host today as we go into our TED Med at CDC. Gregory Sunshine oversees the Disaster and Public Health Emergency Declaration Law Project, as well as a number of other public health law research topics on emergency preparedness and response. Prior to coming to CDC, he coordinated bioterrorism preparedness and emergency response at the Baltimore City Health Department, including events such as Hurricane Sandy. Today, Gregory is going to be talking to us on Ebola monitoring and movement protocols. Does CDC's opinion even count?
Thank you. So I'm here to talk about the role that CDC plays in our public health and legal systems. Basically, does our opinion count? Who has to listen to what we say? So I want to start with a quick anecdote, and many of you might be familiar with this story. It's a story of John Snow, who's credited with being the father of epidemiology. In London in the 1850s, there was a severe cholera epidemic in a certain neighborhood, and John Snow was the first person to take a map and actually plot on that map where each ill person lived. And through this, he was able to determine that they likely used the same water pump. And that's epidemiology. Thanks to that, we now know that cholera is spread through contaminated water. And that's where the story ends in public health schools. But we like to tell people that he then continued and actually petitioned the city council to remove the handle from the pump. And that's public health law. That's using government authority to take action to better the public's health and well-being. But unfortunately, the story doesn't end there. Because once the epidemic started to subside, people started to get better, and they were frustrated with how far they had to walk to get their water, they actually put the handle back on the pump, and more people got sick. So I want you to think about those three aspects of the story throughout my presentation: finding the pump, taking the handle off, and keeping the handle off. So this is an approximation of global air travel in a 24-hour period. Thanks to this, people and their diseases can circumnavigate the globe in less than a day. And so any kind of international public health issue is also a domestic concern. That's why on October 10th, WHO reported that over 4,000 people had died at that point in the Ebola epidemic. So the next day, CDC announced entry screening at 5 US airports to identify travelers from West Africa and screen them for signs and symptoms of Ebola. In the first month, over 2,000 people were screened, and they had destinations in almost all 50 states. Since then, thousands more have been screened and monitored for signs and symptoms of Ebola. Now, a few weeks after screening began, a healthcare worker in New York who had served in Guinea tested positive for Ebola. The next day, the governors of New York and New Jersey announced that they were implementing a policy that required mandatory quarantine for healthcare workers who served in West Africa. This was on a Friday. That Monday, CDC released interim guidance for the monitoring and movement of persons with potential Ebola virus exposure. And this updated previous guidance by establishing risk assessment categories, monitoring requirements like reporting your temperature to the health department, and movement restrictions like avoiding public transportation. Now, unlike the New York and New Jersey policies, these did not include mandatory quarantine. After this eventful weekend, some states began issuing policies that were equal to or aligned with CDC's recommendations. But others did not follow CDC guidance and issued or maintained policies that required mandatory quarantine. And this creates a problem. Because when we have potential responders who are unsure as to how they're going to be treated when they return, how does that affect the response? Well, according to Dr. Raj Shah, then administrator of USAID, when we saw the actions taken in New Jersey in particular, partners immediately had to withdraw their proposals and say instead of building 2 or 3 Ebola treatment units, we can only do one because so many doctors have backed out because, understandably, they don't know what the situation is going to be like when they return. So uncertainty hurts response. But then who said that states could just pass their own policies without having to follow CDC guidance? Well, these guys. The framers of the Constitution, when they wrote the Constitution, they gave specific enumerated powers to the federal government. This is found in Article 1, Section 8. And these include the power of interstate commerce, the power to tax and spend, and the power to provide national defense. Now, for the states, they get everything else. And this is because in the Bill of Rights, specifically the 10th Amendment, which states, the powers not delegated to the United States are reserved to the states. This is the broad power. Everything we haven't given to the federal government goes to the states. And in this broad power, we find the police power, which is the power to take extraordinary action to protect the public. So to pass laws and regulations to protect the public's health, welfare, morals, and promote the common good. And this has been supported by the Supreme Court, that it's the state's 10th Amendment police powers to take measures to prohibit or mandate certain actions. And through this, we get a separation of powers, referred to as federalism, or in more delectable terms, a layer cake of authorities, where at the top, we have the federal government with its enumerated powers, and this includes the power to tax and spend, so that's how we can make grants or tax exemptions to promote certain actions. But in the middle, it's the states. They have everything else. They have the police powers of public health control. And in some instances, localities can be delegated certain powers as well, so we have that bottom layer. So because of federalism, states can make their own policies even with clear federal guidance. But this creates a problem when you're trying to mount a national response to an international health emergency. So for clarity, the Public Health Law Program was asked to create a resource that collected all of these policies and coded them to determine what each state was doing and how they differed from CDC guidance. So Dawn Pepin, another attorney in our office, and I conducted a systematic collection of each state's monitoring and movement policies. Now, not every state issued an executive order, and no states passed specific laws or regulations for returning travelers. So when I say policy, I'm referring to official government statements of what their intent was for returning travelers. So this means any government statement that we could find online. So press releases, informational websites, and even health orders if they were posted online. Now, we only use official government documents because we wanted to make sure that this was exactly what the federal government, the state governments were communicating to the public. So we didn't use any news websites, and we excluded private correspondence because we didn't want to rely on any information that not everyone else could obtain. Remember, the point of this was clarity and to reduce any kind of confusion. And if we were relying on a document that was sent directly to us that not everyone else could access, then the whole purpose is lost. So we collected these documents through basically a lot of Googling, and we coded them as more restrictive, equal to, or less restrictive than CDC guidance. So more restrictive meant that states had policies that described more burdensome reporting requirements or more stringent movement restrictions. So for instance, CDC guidance permits people categorized in the high risk to leave their home so long as they remain at least 3 feet away from other individuals, don't use public transportation, and don't engage in public gatherings. Now if a state required someone to stay at home for 21 days and have no contact with anyone else, then that state would be categorized as more restrictive. And this also referred to monitoring requirements as well. So, for example, CDC guidance does not require people in the no identifiable risk category to report their temperature to the health department. If a state did require them to report their temperature, then that state would be categorized as more restrictive. Now, for states that equaled CDC guidance, they mirrored the guidance, or they issued a statement saying, we are following CDC recommendations. Now, less restrictive are policies that are less stringent than CDC recommendations. And this could be a situation where a state is allowing everyone who's returning to go to work regardless of the risk level, when CDC guidance recommends that people in the high or some risk categories stay home from work for 21 days. Now, policies that are ambiguous were marked as unclear. And in the beginning, this was usually a situation where a state provided a link to the CDC guidance, but didn't say whether they were following that guidance or just providing the link for informational purposes. And in some instances, we weren't able to find a policy at all, and those were marked as no policy. And once we collected everything, we put it in this one-stop shop table where we had the exact text that we were relying on and the categorization, so people could look at this table and see exactly what their state was doing. And we also put it into a nice colored map so people could see exactly what the landscape was on this issue. This was then posted online and also sent directly to health officers and the health department attorneys. So how did states feel about this? We had 6 states reach out and have questions about their categorization. So we explain our protocol, that we could only rely on publicly available documents, the coding criteria, and we showed them the exact text that we were relying on. In all of those instances, the states either updated their language, added a new document, or we were able to use a new resource to update the language that we were relying on. So what did we find? We have 19 states that are more restrictive, 34 that are equal, none that are less restrictive. One territory is unclear, and this is a situation where there's a press release that predated the screening process and provides general advice that travelers should monitor their temperature. And it wasn't clear that this is actually the policy that the state is implementing for returning travelers. And two territories where we have not been able to find a policy. So, does CDC's opinion count? Yes. First, 60% of the states are following CDC guidance. All of the states are at least incorporating the direct active monitoring recommendations, and no states or territories are less restrictive. Also, when we first posted this resource online back in December, we had 14 states and territories that had no policy or they were unclear. Now there's only three. And last, let's look at a highly publicized case where one of these state monitoring policies was actually challenged in court. So Casey Hickox was a healthcare worker who served in Sierra Leone. After she returned, spent some time in New Jersey, she went back to her home state of Maine. And there, the health department required her to quarantine at home for 21 days. She challenged this in court and forced the health department to justify its actions to a judge. And here's what the judge had to say, and I'm going to paraphrase for the sake of clarity. At this point in time, the only information that the court has before it regarding the dangers of infection derives from the director of the Maine Health Department, together with the attachments from the U.S. Centers for Disease Control. And from this information, he concludes that while Ms. Hickox must continue with direct active monitoring, the state has not proved that limiting her movements to the degree requested is necessary to protect other individuals from the dangers of infection. According to the information presented to the court, Hickox currently does not show any symptoms of Ebola and is therefore not infectious. That's a judge considering only the science and evidence put before him to determine the freedom of a person. And CDC guidance plays a pivotal role in making this decision. So that's what counts. CDC's presentation of good evidence-based scientific guidance. When we do our jobs, courts of law listen, and our guidance becomes legally significant. Because even though we have federalism, and the federal government can't mandate or prohibit certain actions, we can issue carefully crafted messages articulating the science, and that's how we better the public's health and well-being. So recall the story of Jon Snow from earlier. That's what counts. We find the pump, the states can take the handle off the pump, and we have the vital role in making sure that the handle stays off. Thank you.
Love the picture of Jonas Salk lecturing at CDC.
Yeah, I wanted to make sure that we had a win up there.
Casey Hickox, former CDC employee and former EIS officer that you referred to, may have had more knowledge than most as she went up against the state. What do you think the impact of that was in her case?
I think it helped. It showed that she had a lot of knowledge about, you know, her risk, what would put her at risk. She was able to clearly articulate exactly what she did when she was over in Sierra Leone, and so she could, you know, clearly tell them what kind of risk exposure she had. And I think that helped create a lot of legitimacy in making her case to the court, who had to consider this evidence and look at her history in determining whether she would be a risk or not to the public.
Thank you.
Thank you.